Chris Brewin asks, aside from the Aztec death whistles you made for Ghostbusters Afterlife, it seems as though you've essentially retired from production prop model building. Is there a director or project that you could see yourself coming out of retirement to work on? That's a question I'm thinking about presently. I have taken a job for hire here in the cave. I'm making a thing for a client. And I'll be able to talk about it eventually. But it is, to be perfectly fair, the first work for hire that I have done since the early aughts, since 2004, I think. I don't think of myself as retired. I'm just addicted to this channel, making these videos, working here in the shop. And if I was going to, look, I mean, Jason Reitman and I talked about bigger swings for me in building props for Afterlife. But the issue is that if I was going to build a bigger prop, like a ghost trap, let's say, or even a proton pack, which was the first thing that I thought of because I'm nuts. You don't just build a prop for a movie. For every prop that's in a movie, you need a hero version and a background version and a stunt version and one for each character. They have electronics. Those electronics need to be serviced. They will break. I hear Bill Murray likes to take his props off as he's walking around the set. Someone needs to chase him around and put them all back together. That's not the kind of service I was going to be able to offer Jason at all. I was going to build a prop and be able to deliver it to the set. And that for that, the Aztec death whistle worked perfectly. But would I come out of retirement to work on props for a film? Yeah, totally. Totally. I do that for Jason. I do that for Peter Jackson. I do that for Guillermo. I mean, you know, I'm not, to me, it's just another opportunity to play with somebody that I admire and to stretch my creative muscles. Send me in, coach. I'm totally down with that. I don't mind the idea of working for hire and also, you know, covering it here on the channel and telling more stories about it. But the idea of taking on work for hire had not occurred to me in almost 20 years until this client reached out and said, hey, would you build one of these things for me? And I named the price and they said, yeah, and we're moving forward with it. Yeah, it's very strange. About a week into this project, I was like, what is this strange feeling? Oh, it's work stress, right? From having a client that I want to make happy, right? That's a bit of stress, which is just a natural part of the working world, but it's one that I hadn't experienced in a long time. I've experienced plenty of other stressors in having television shows and doing stage shows and YouTube channels and all that stuff. There's plenty of things to get stressed out about, but like there's a unique stress to having to make something for a client that's museum quality that they're going to approve that you want to make them happy. Yeah, it's a nice mindset to go back to. I mean, you know, I've been a freelancer for my whole adult life. We got time for one more? All right, let's see here. Clinton Anderson. It's not a question, but a comment, and yet I have an answer. Clinton Anderson says, if international travel was a thing again, Adam would make an excellent contestant on the UK comedy game show Taskmaster. Please don't mistake it with the American one, he says, which was awful. He'd also make a fantastic guest on QI while he was over there. Okay, so let me talk to you for just a second about Taskmaster and QI. First of all, don't you think that John Hodgman and I should host QI here in the United States? Don't you think we should boot it here in the United States with John Hodgman and I as hosts, right? Right? I don't care who is the Stephen Fry and who's the other. Doesn't matter to me how we break it down. I just think that would be a really fun show for us to do together. So, and I love QI. I love, love that show. Great show. Taskmaster? Yes. Yes. Again, send me in, coach. I would do that show in a heartbeat. I would love to. It's a great show. Yeah. Thank you, Clinton. I agree with you. I think not only that I might make an excellent contestant, but I think I'd have a lot of fun, and that sounds really good. Okay, let's see here. I think that was a quick one. So I want to get, someone's asking me about Dune versions that have been out so far. Look, I've only seen the Lynch version and the Villeneuve version. I did not watch the television show. But I think it's clear how I feel about that. So Emily Christiansen says, my Excalibur moment. Oh, sweet. Emily is referring to me like going to see Excalibur when I was 14 and how much it started, kickstarted my love of armor and lusty knight tales. She says, my Excalibur moment was the first Iron Man film in 08. 10-year-old me immediately ran home and made a suit of armor out of corrugated cardboard and paper. Parens, ouch. Yeah, armor bites are a real thing. It had a huge impact on my educational prospects as well. Pursuing mathematics, computer science, data science, and the imagery of a cool nerd still inspires me now as a master's student. That is freaking awesome, Emily. She wants to know, are there any movies or TV shows that you think had a major impact on fledgling scientists, engineers, makers that perhaps don't get the credit they are due? Well, Beekman's World, absolutely. But I do, see, I think we're all talking about many of the main ones. I think that there are places in which people find inspiration. Like, I know that the first Short Circuit movie had a huge effect on a whole bunch of, like, I've talked to so many engineers for which that was, like, a really important early movie. I've also talked to some Indian engineers who were like amazed to see an Indian character in a film and only learned later in life that that was Fisher Stevens, not an actual Indian actor. I'm not sure I have an answer to this. Obviously, I do autograph lines at the cons and people come up and they talk about Mythbusters, but we're talking about Mythbusters, right? I think this is a deeper question that I really want to think about, Emily, because it is a good one. And specifically covering, I'll tell you what, for me, one of the earliest things that got my juices flowing as a maker, as a designer, as a thinker, was Wild Wild West with Robert Conrad. Not the film with Will Smith, the TV show that was on in the 60s and the 70s. There's an aspect of that show that made fun of itself and broke the fourth wall in a way that I got even as a kid. Like I understood that they were doing that. There was also a way in which that show incorporated technology in a way that was really nifty and inspiring to me. Like, it's like the central narrative of Wild Wild West is that clever people will eventually win, right? And that's a great narrative. It's not necessarily true, but it's a great narrative and it's thrilling. Get Smart. Yeah, the opening sequence of Get Smart with all the doors opening and closing. Dude, every single one of my Lego constructions throughout my entire childhood had multiple doors and they're all inspired by Get Smart. Mission Impossible, the original Mission Impossible. So I'm naming all these things from the 60s and the 70s because that's when I grew up. I'll tell you what, we're going to cut these questions apart and put them up on YouTube. If you're watching this on YouTube, I'd love to hear in the comments what inspired you into engineering or science or just into something you didn't expect. Because I'm of a time when Back to the Future is actually a little young for me. I was a little old for that movie when it first came out. And we're all part of the cultural wave we're part of, and some things get past us. So my knowledge of things after the mid 80s is pretty limited, and I'd love to hear your guys' take on it. I think that's a great place to wrap it up. Tested patrons, your questions remain thrilling to answer. Thank you so much for submitting them. If you'd like to find out how to support us and be a patron, we'll include some links. Thank you guys so much for joining me for this live stream. Happy Thanksgiving, happy Indigenous Peoples Day, happy holidays. I hope that the time with your family is healing and generative. I send you big hugs from here in my cave. And I'll see you guys next time.